Cholas, you've dived into their world, you've read the stories of their trade, their military, their art, and it's a life for you. But how do you communicate what you see so vividly to a reader who may have no idea who or what a Chola is? Where do you begin? Plot, character, setting?
Okay. I think in the case of Empire, what I did was I started with a person's internal life. So Aramis and Anantha are introduced in the prologue, and we follow them over the next chapters that come. And what I tried to do was focus on, in the case of Aramis, her homesickness, the fact that she's missing where she's from, and she's trying to adapt to a new country and new culture. And all this is something I think most people can relate to some extent. So you bridge the distance between where we are now in the present to that period in the past that way. And I used her as the perspective by which to introduce how the Cholas live, what they eat, how they, you know, what their markets look like, the clothes they wear and so on. So I tried to make it more of a relatable character to which you see a completely different time period and culture. I did a fair amount of research on the kind of food and clothing and surroundings based on as many regular people accounts I could find. Like, there are all these wandering poets who, as you know, walk around the Chola country and write verses about the people and the food. I use that as one of the main ways to get an understanding of what the culture is like for ordinary people outside the palaces and so on.
How did Aramis come to you? How did you come up with a character like this? This gives us a sort of outsider perspective into the Chola period.
Actually, a lot of academic history helped me in that particular sense. When I was reading about the Cholas, I do read history as a sort of a hobby. When I was reading about the Cholas, one of the details that I came across was one, the existence of women guards in the Chola King's palace. And the second detail was the fact that there were a lot of foreign settlers in the Chola country who come there to trade and eventually settled there and actually made a life there and started doing work in the Chola Empire and so on. So the idea of somebody who's foreign, because we tend to view migration as a very modern problem, but when you look at this period, there was so much naval trade happening between countries that there were a lot of people moving around as well, and a lot of people trying to integrate into strange environments. So the idea was to have somebody who was a girl, who was foreign in this country, and who had a job which had both a great amount of responsibility, but not a lot of respect. Just those characteristics appealed to me, and I guess that's how she sort of came about. I'm also a migrant myself. I grew up in Dubai, and I moved to India for college. And that a little bit of that standing on the outside looking in is very relatable.
I was going to ask you, how true were you to the facts of history? Were there any times that you took, went off grid into certain liberties?
Yeah, that's why it's historical fiction. But I tried to do as much research as possible to get the small details right. But in terms of big plot changes, there is of course the fake queen. I'm obsessed with the idea of a doppelganger character. You see it in so much of literature, both European as well as Indian literature. There is this work done by this King Kamsa, I think it's called the Priyadarshika. So in it he writes about a king falling in love with a woman who has dressed up to look like his queen but is not actually the queen. And there is sort of like a deception going on that is sort of mutually agreed upon by two parties. And I think in India we are obsessed with the idea of the double in Bollywood as well, right? There are all those double roles that people constantly play, and so many of these are female characters, right? So you really did so many double roles during the time. And I think that part fascinated me, and that is definitely not part of actual history. Other pieces, Aramis is of course a fictional character, although there are elements of her you find in history. People who are in the book are sometimes loosely based on historical characters people mentioned. Like, for example, there is a character of Chetty Sethi, the merchant. So there is an actual essay about these Tamil merchants, of which one of the people mentioned is Chetty Sethi, and aspects like that. But yeah, broadly, other plot points like the attack on the civilians and all that stuff is based on actual history.
Has the novel one thing that's so surprising is that actually that period of time, it was so very cosmopolitan and global. You know, you have Animus was a Greek character, you have, you know, the Shivijains as well. We've forgotten this history, we're not so aware of it anymore.
Yeah.
Why do you think that is?
I find that really surprising as well. I think I remember history in school. Maybe I was a bit of an indifferent student. I don't know what it was, but I remember history in school as a list of dates and a list of kingdoms and so on. We didn't learn very much in terms of the actual details of the empires and interesting and cultures and so on. So I think we missed a huge part of what makes these time periods very fascinating. And I think there's something that people talk about is that the Mughals are covered a great deal in popular media now, and we talk about them a lot more. But I think these smaller kingdoms, like the Cholas, have been ignored, even though the culture is extremely fascinating.
Extremely fascinating. How important are lifestyle aspects like food and fashion when you're building a world?
Okay, I'm a big food lover, so I think food is extremely important. I think it's a way to connect people sensually to a place and time, especially when you describe recipes and so on. It connects in a way that is much. It gets people past the reading of a, you know, very standard description about a particular period of time. And fashion, I didn't focus that much on. Food was a big part of it, as was the descriptions of how, for example, the neighborhoods are like in these kind of places, and how I tried to get Aramis to walk through the towns and walk by the seaside and get a sense of the local population and the place more than anything. Fashion is a little bit difficult for me because I'm not sure how much of it is popular fashion and how much of it is what the royalty wear in the stories and in the descriptions from that time. So I was a little bit careful about that particular part. The only place where I took some liberties is with Ananta's wife and her fondness for those brocade silks. So it's a great way to communicate a person's character through that kind of detail, because vanity is one of the most revealing things about a person. Right? They can't hide their love for like clothing or dressing themselves up and so on.
Now, what were the fun bits you like?
I don't want to say the fun bits for the sex bits. Those things, the lovemaking actually made me quite uncomfortable to write, and I think that's sort of obvious because I don't linger on the descriptions. The fun bits to write, I think, were the war scenes for me. I loved writing action-packed scenes because there's so much happening and you get to, like, you know, just cut a path through the story, like, really, really fast. And one of the reasons I wanted to write a battle scene was also that the fact that battle scenes, you imagine them to be very prolonged, but I think these kind of wars used to happen very quickly. And the winners and the losers used to be determined very fast because so many people would die in a short period of time and so on. So that was my favorite part.
And with that, you know, how much of it was imagination, how much of it was research with the battle scenes?
Research for me was a way to get interesting detail that it's that whole thing about you don't know what you don't know. So the more reading I did, the more I was able to get past my preconceived notions of how people were or what kind of culture they were like. For example, I realized that these were people with a great sense of humor and they were very playful in their approach towards life. They had a love for daily living and they weren't as religious and as structured a society as some texts make it out to be. One of the ways I actually discovered that was through some poetry that I had read from the Chola period, which involved a description of demons and their taste for human flesh. And I don't know if you've come across this one. It's quite lovely. He talks about the fact that there are these demons who are waiting for the Chola king to wage war on Kalinga, so there will be enough bodies on the battlefield to feast on. And when the battle eventually happens, there is this amazing description of these demons, like, you know, cooking their meal. Yeah. And there is a cook, like, stirring the food with a severed hand.
Oh.
And there are these Brahmin demons waiting for the battlefield sambar, which is made out of blood. And the Jain demons strain their sambar so there's no hair in it. The Buddhist demons like their sambar made out of greens. And all of it is from this lovely passage of medieval poetry. And I was like, this is amazing. I mean, this is like so funny and so interesting at the same time. The bit about the female royal bodyguard was also out of research, and I don't think I think that element made a big difference to how I structured the story, and that came purely out of my reading of a lot of this historical texts.
Tell us a little bit about romance in the 11th century. I know you don't want to talk about sex scenes, but courtship, romance, did people fall in love? How did people fall in love? Did they fall in love?
I think the idea of eternal romantic love is a very modern notion. I think lots of marriages happened for property, it was basically arranged between families. But I think love existed. There's a lot of love poetry from the Sangam period, and it's very evocative and very emotional. Some of the, like for example, but I also think there might have been an element of cynicism regarding the overlap of love and sex, because one of the things that I have Aramis in terms of how she approaches her sexual relationship with Nakeshan, her experience with sex is basically seeing how the concubines talk about sex and how they behave about, you know, their sexual relationships, which are obviously based on power and, you know, give take in terms of monarchy, in terms of a monarchy structure and so on. But so I wanted it to be a little ambivalent, and which is why I think I am a bit, I didn't want to make it a great love story, what happens between her and the other soldier, as well as what happens between her and Kamakshi. I wanted it to seem like it's a little bit of a transactional relationship and a little bit of an emotional relationship combined, so that we don't take our modern ideas about love and impose it on that. At least that's what I was trying to do. I don't know if I fully succeeded, partly because I think a lot of the personal relationship between her and Nakeshan, you get diverted from that because all the other stuff is happening in the story. So I deliberately didn't like focus too much on
that. And as a major power, can you tell us a little bit about that particularly and how that affects the culture of that empire?
Okay. Kanakalata Mukunda is this writer who's written about the trading world of Tamil merchant, and a lot of her writing also focuses on the Chola period, because that was a period when a lot of people travelled from the Chola ports to eastern coast, for example, and settled there, and actually became like prominent members of the society there. There was a record of one particular Tamil person becoming like the regional head of a small state in East Asia. And what I think is fascinating about the time is that the Chola kingdom was unusually outward looking. So they had a very strong navy, some estimates number it to as large as 1,000 ships. And this navy was not only well known across Asia as, you know, a very prominent sea force, but it was what primarily helped them capture such large swaths of East Asia and so on. And the commander of the navy was also the commander of the army, but he was especially respected for the number of ships under his control and so on. And ranks within were also determined by how many ships you commanded as an officer. And it was a big deal for somebody to captain a ship. And that was like key to your status in the Chola Empire. And I think these were very fascinating details. That's why I included as much as I could about court life and about and the main character is essentially somebody who's a navy captain, who's also the commander and so on. And the sea voyage as a result was a lot of fun to write. The way the Chola ships were built also were considered architectural marvels. There are some historians who say that they didn't believe in using iron the ships because they were afraid of it rusting. So they would actually connect the boards using very complicated, like rope knots and I believe a certain kind of glue that they made with kind of resin and so on. And these ships were still extremely seaworthy and could travel vast distances. So that part was pretty cool.
Very interesting. Can you talk a little bit about your character, Aramis? I mean, he's good narrator as well. She's not entirely a positive character.
I think one of the reasons that she's not a positive character is, I think, you know, when you watch these old Western movies or even movies today in Hollywood, I think even girls in the audience end up relating to the male characters more because they have so much more to do and they're more complex characters. While often the women are the wife or the daughter or something very like one. And I think that's beginning to change only now with a lot of female leads starting to happen, at least in Hollywood. So I wanted her to be a somewhat of a complex character who had mixed motivations about a lot of things, to make a lot of mistakes and, you know, pay for those mistakes as well. And I wanted her to be a little grey but also have people empathize with her. And that was a deliberate effort on my part to not make her a stereotypical narrator, female narrator in that sense. And she gets angry of me, she gets jealous of me, and all of that is true.
The intrigue and the politics and the danger of the Solapur, there's a part that I love in your novel. Can you talk a little bit about that, like, the historical basis? Was the Solapur that seething with intrigue and politics?
Well, yeah, that's a good question, because I couldn't find, the historical references are very polite, right, about the Solapur. There's not that much you can find. What you can find in sidelong references are in the poetry and in some descriptions about women winning favors with certain senior members of the court sexually and so on. But in terms of the actual court intrigue, I had to use non-Chola sources to get an idea of how medieval construction. For example, there is a lovely Japanese work based around the 11th century that talks about the courts in Japan and how family intrigue worked in that period there. Through a lot of Chinese whispers and rumors spread in corridors. So yeah, this was something that I had to like pick out and tackle.
So my final question is, how would the Cholas have fared in the Game of Thrones? Would they have captured the Iron Throne?
It's really hard to say. I don't know whether they would have captured the Iron Throne, because nobody has dragons in the Chola Empire, and dragons are apparently instrumental. But I think Rajendra Chola was a very savvy king. Most of his decisions, whether to go to war or to capture territory, were extremely strategic. So I think he would definitely be smarter than somebody like Cersei in terms of building alliances and when to go aggressive and when to hold back. And I think in that sense, he has a lot of strengths that might have served him well. And when you see how the Chola Empire was structured, he had managed to build a lot of allies, even in areas that he hadn't fully conquered along the east coast. And I think that is critical to building the kind of force that you need to wage a war like that. And I think that's what they show about Daenerys, right? She's very good at minimizing the amount of violence that is required in achieving her endgame. And that is the sign of somebody who at least deserves to be on the island, even whether they are successful.
Thank you so much, David.
Thank you so much.
It's a really wonderful pleasure talking to you, and this is a fantastic conversation.
Thank you. Thank you.